spots are mine. The pieces I made were inspirations of faculty and so on before that. And so these came about in 1975. I graduated in 68. But I've always said that I was a slow learner. I think they need more time to develop. They expect too much instant.
Years or whatever they found at home. James Tisdale's one. He wanted to make pots. And he went to the long distance runner. But, you know, Japanese pottery was discovered in Japan. That's the name of the game. So, anyways, I'm talking about going on 7 years old or whatever, you know. And I'd say, this is really wonderful material. I think, well, where can I go to study this? So, this guy who was teaching the class said, well, you can go up to Western New York, Buffalo. So, I said, you can go to Alfred, which is, as Chuck refers to, as the A school. That's the most famous, was the most famous, from my work. Graduate program. It was Syracuse University, and then now there's this place called the School for American Production. I put together a portfolio of about 3 pitch pots, a couple of toilet pots, and a sled pots, and some drawings that I had done. And those pots are all taken with my little camera against the burlap background. And the pots were about that big. So, rejection from Alfred, rejection from Syracuse. But I teased him and said, well, we have space available. You can come as a special student and do remedial work. I had no idea. And now, if you're going to the graduate work, you study where to go because you know who the teachers are at our school. You go on. I had no idea what was at that. It was so naive on my part. But, in some way, it was much better that I followed the school. Now that I studied with the John Kimmerman, who had worked at the Bauhaus, who was this romantic old German, who was his dream of us. But he was just what I needed. And when, doctor on the first day, he said, that's your wheel. I said, good. How do you use it? And he said, how in hell's name did you ever get this school? And you know, have you ever heard that Bill Cosby, God's name is God damn it? For the first year, I thought my name was in hell's name. So I was always referred to in hell's name. How did you do that? In hell's name, why did you do that? That's hilarious. And I mean, I have to say I had a hard time with him. In the end, it turned out we had a good relationship. And I am the most significant figure in my life in learning. He was the first real artist I ever met. So, but he just started falling into it. And I had to make time to start studying this. You know, it's all like this. State. We met Nebraska over a case that no one not here, I believe it was.
Yeah, we didn't. We just wanted to see what it looked like. Other people who no, we didn't. Always wanted to.
Oh, yeah. For me?
What happened that you, what did you like happen there with the spell?
Mm-hmm. Way to either emphasize, make the body maybe smaller, visually put a bigger spout, bigger viewing line, or if you want to emphasize that, put a little bit smaller spout. And for me right now, yeah, the spout is just too big. Doesn't really have anything to do to the conscious of it, it's more visual.
Right. More in diameter or length or both?
Diameter that time. Along the way, study judgments made is whether or not that works in the form. I think two pots are probably the most difficult forms to make because of all the parts that go together to make it up. Only functionally, I think visually it's very important also.
Back in 1950s.
You know, one that comes to mind real quick, I mean, that was, I saw a, you know, we're in a leadership. I'm not speaking ill of him in any way, but I always felt that he was a much better craftsman and printmaker than he was Potter. And he had a show on Shibaraki. And a lot of his prints were in the show, an awful lot of them. I was really impressed with that show. Like I said, I've always enjoyed his prints more than I have his pots. Not that I don't like his pots, but I think his work as a printmaker, craftsman, is much stronger.
Working on mine. Don't you think of what I'm not sure I said last.
Ron, I noticed you using the rib on the inside of the plot.
Uh-huh.
Do that for compression or what are you?
Compression. And also not so much for shaping there, but the compression, get rid of the finger marks. Not so much on the inside, but on the outside. Now, if I were to use underglazes on there, I don't want to paint over the throwing marks. I want that a fairly flat surface.
Since I've never seen not many people anyway using a rib on the inside, throwing a cylindrical form.
Ah, more for shaping, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
right,
to give
right.
it that curve. I use it as control.
Okay.
I mean, that's the way I was trained. That's the European style, I think, or whatever, was to, you know, get rid of the finger mark by pushing down on it, compacting. But mainly it was to get rid of those little throwing marks that were in there.
That ragged edge on that spout on purpose. And when I threw pots, pitchers, teapots, something that poured, I like that ragged edge. Not, that's about the only time I would promote that. It's because once that liquid hits that spot, you tip it back and the liquid cuts off at that point. It doesn't dribble down the front. It's like, you'll see different Asian teapots, Japanese, Chinese, Korean, that have a plastic shield over the spout. And people think that's to protect the spout and shield. Actually, what it does is it can be that hard edge. So when you rock the form back, the liquid cuts off there. It doesn't dribble down the front. And that's why, on purpose, I'll do that with the teapots. This one worked out the way I rolled it out. If not, I would go back, if that worked a little bit thicker, and I'd cut it with a knife.
So these pots could be
too well. All right. He also, yeah, he's got to live with me, work with me, and I can make your life hell, partner. Anyway, so sit tight until the other people get here, and then I'll do a quick intro, okay? Yeah, Ron Meyers and Chuck Hindes here. They've got an exhibition, as most of you, maybe all of you know, up in the museum. And with a lot of help, we were able to get them in. Ron's come to us from his home in Athens, Georgia, and Chuck has come from his home in Washington State. So they flew in day before yesterday and are spending today. Got a little work done in the studio yesterday, but you know, the rest of the workshop is today. And both Chuck and Ron are emeritus professors from their respective institutions, which they've retired from. Ron spent a number of years teaching at University of Georgia, and Chuck was at University of Iowa, and the work ethic these guys have, I think, is really instrumental in them being recognized at the level they are in contemporary American ceramics. They come to the work with a real healthy respect for the fusion of the past and the present and the future. And I think that was the big thing for me, looking at both of their work. I was Chuck's grad student at the University of Iowa back in the 80s, and perhaps the most important lesson I learned as a young artist was not to dismiss anything, or to do so at my own peril. Chuck's work was always very challenging to me. It was not something I was familiar with, and I'd been working in quite a long time before I became a grad student. And I had to be a pretty quick study to really understand what Chuck was about with his work. The thing I like, and Ron is the same way. If you've noticed, he's not interested so much in symmetry as he is in the undulation, the meandering path. In terms of the compositions he creates and the potential of the material he's manipulating. These were things that were kind of alien to me. I was taught kind of in an academic manner, traditional manner, to be very tight, very controlling with my forms, perhaps very Scandinavian in the distillation of form and to exercise my control over the form. And to encounter work that is so obviously an agreeable dance between two very strong partners, the artist and the material, was kind of a revelation to me. And throughout my graduate work and ever since, I've been watching Chuck. That was back in the 80s. I've been watching Chuck's influence just grow in the resurgence of interest in wood firing in America. And it's been a real education for me. I've been fortunate enough to land at Baylor and been working here for 20, this is my 26th year, but the one thing I've been very, very conscious of throughout that entire time is the caliber of the program I'm building, the comprehensiveness of the program I'm building, and what my students get inside them during this time here so that they can go out into the world and be conversant with, not only with people who look alike and sound alike, but people who are very different with different ideas and different perspectives and responses to life. So this is a great opportunity. Chuck and Ron have collectively, individually and collectively, provided tremendous educational experience and educational grounding for countless people who are now really shaping the future of American ceramics. And we're lucky to have them here. And they're both very good storytellers. They're both extremely informative instructors. Chuck looks grouchy, but he'll give you, he'll respond to any question you have with a complete answer and probably some very good anecdotes thrown in on top of it. So these are good people. We're fortunate to have them, and it's a real honor for me to have these two people here. I've been looking up to these people most of my life. So
looking down.
Yeah, well, there's that too. There's that too. And I thought that's the way it was done. And I get to Iowa, Chuck's program, and you know, he gets all the new graduates together, and he says, "Well, see you in a couple of weeks for crit." Well, and I'm thinking it's going to be this crit like this. We've got the pot, you know, pieces right here. And, but now, about 2.5 weeks later, I'm working in my studio, and Chuck made it real clear right from the start. He told all. Got all the graduates in a semicircle, first week, first day, and he said, "This is the only chance you're going to get in this life, in your life, to have this opportunity in the studio." He says, "You got keys, you got 24-hour access to the studio. If you're not trying to, if you don't understand why it's important to be here as close to 24 hours a day as you can, this is not the grad program for you." And so I kind of got the message that he was expecting to see some work at a crit. So I'm working in my studio. Chuck's not around, you know, and I'm working every day. And then all of a sudden, one day, about 2.5 weeks in, here comes Chuck into the studio. And I guess I had a pretty nice studio. And he comes in just like, and he walks out the door. On his way out the door, he says, "Is that the best you got?" And he's gone. He's not standing around and talking. That was my crit. That was my crit, and some of the other graduates got, you know, the other graduates got the same kinds of crits, and you know, we meet kind of in each other's studio and go, "That, what was your crit like?" And people were thinking there, you know, there was a little sense of outrage, and like, "Well, we deserve to get a real crit." And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, "Is that the best we got?" "No, I guess it's not the best I got." And so it was, you know, the next two weeks, you try to try to do it the best you can. And he comes in and you walk out the door. You know, it's like, and those are your crits. And it, but that was really important for me because it was, you know, it's like, and there were times, I'll admit, there were times he'd walk out the door after, "Is that the best you got?" You know, and it was like, "I'll show you the best I got." And sometimes it was that energy that just pushed you, you know, a little harder, a little harder, a little harder in the studio. And I mean, we got a lot more from Chuck than those really brief crits. But for those of you that are thinking of going into grad school, you got to be ready for the unexpected and the unfamiliar. And if you get to grad school and it's really familiar, I suggest you be the one to turn on the motor that drives you to turn over rocks and go places that aren't familiar and aren't comfortable. Because Chuck's right, it's the only time in your life you'll have that. You know, I'm a senior professor now, fully tenured and all that, and I have a fraction of the time to commit to my studio and developing work that I had as a grad student. And I look back on those 2.5 years, I mean, there was nothing in my life remotely like that. And so if you're going to grad school, you know, go when you're ready, because you got to get as close to 24 hours a day, 7 days a week if you can, if you're going to get out of it what's there. But Chuck was really good about pushing me in that direction. And I think, you know, maybe he treated other grads differently behind closed doors, but I think he knew what buttons of mine he needed to push to get the response, you know, that I ended up giving. But that was good. That was good.
I thought the bricks were always the choices. That's for the kill building
class. That's the kill building class. Yeah.
Hey, Paul. Did you ever build a kill that just didn't work?
Are you kidding?
Be honest with her, Chuck.
Really?
I had a nickel for every one of those I had to tear down.
Do you remember when that guy came from Florida? What was his name? Gainesville, and built that kiln and was going to burn out the frame?
Oh, no, that was for just before the Woodfire Conference in 91. We built this big, I was just going to tell that story.
Okay.
We built this long, 26-foot Anaconda with two doors in it. You know what Anaconda is, too, good.
So it did this and did that, so you can't just pull a form out in a gas kiln. So somebody suggested we burn it out, so we did that. And I left with this friend of mine, Gary Haskins, who had come to go to the conference. And so we went home, and we came back a couple hours later. And I walked out the back door, and the other teacher, Bunny McBride, was standing with several students. One of them was looking at me. There were all these long faces, and I thought, what's the problem, man? I looked at the kill, and the front half was gone. We had just packed wet clay on it, insulated earthenware clay, local clay, and the form didn't burn out fast enough to shoot through the chimney because there were a lot of baffles in the structure of the form. So it formed a steam seal between the clay and the brick, and it blew up. So half the kiln went up like this and then came down. So I'm standing there looking at this kiln, and then I looked over and saw what happened. And I thought I took it very well. I just got in this friend of mine, Gary, and I said, let's go. And so we stopped at John's Grocery on the way home for a bottle of scotch. And pounded half of that down, and I didn't swear. I mean, usually that's first resort for me, but I just, we got the scotch, went home. I came back the next morning, and as you go out that door I'm telling you about, there's a big blackboard. And written in big, bold letters, it says, don't call Chuck, he knows. He's been there and done that. So, yeah, I've had kills that haven't worked. And how many people can invite, you know, all the wood fire fighters in the country to come to your place and report? You know, luckily, most of them, we had a few days, so we tore it down and we put a form back up.
You're going to ask Chuck.
I know.
Building it. I didn't know. It's not a
I wish I could make lots of this.
Maybe that's something that attracted us to one another. I mean, I'd seen his work for years, liked it, was inspired by it, but somehow in coming and going, we never seemed to have met up. And then we met at the NSECA conference at Penn State, and we were introduced to what, Jerry Chappelle?
Yeah. How long ago was that?
Stagecoach left there, but it was in 79, if I remember correctly. It's been quite a while.
It may have been early because Jerry was still I can't remember, but it was
back before 1980. We just hit it off. Best of friends. Done a number of workshops together at different places like Penn and Anderson Ranch.
I was just wondering, why exactly are you shooting fish? Why don't you pour a lot of your stuff at fish on?
Yeah, isn't that great?
I was just wondering why exactly also the design of the others. Why?
Well, I mean, Allison, there's about, I only did these fish because she was talking about them. Because I could have put other things out here, too. But I grew up with fish, too. Swim, I mean, not commercially, not swimming with them, but fishing for them, growing up on a lake. So I kind of, but it also, if you think about this elongated form that they have generally, I mean, there are some round fish, too. But there's this long fish, and it fits any form that you make. So you can pick where you are. So I'm putting that in my environment. So, and also the first, back to working again, at school, I made these serving platters. So when my teacher asked me, what would you serve on? Why don't you put an image on there that people could suggest to them what to serve on? So that was the first decoration. Something connected to it. And I don't like guppies. I don't want sweet fish. You know, I want some, I love the fish that eat other fish. Yeah, they had that sort of lower jaw, pike, and muskie, and barracuda. Oh, those ones of fish with attitude are really important. Yeah.
Does salmon make that hard?
Salmon can do that, yeah.
They get to that level.
Yeah. Bigger drawings of those where they sort of all show up, I did these family portraits. I mean, I did a show one time, all the usual suspects. Yeah, that's right, because I've been doing them so long now. Like, they're all on there. And I think I love those family portraits. Mm-hmm. So, those are an occasional. When I get a break and I can't work. You know, like at the end, let's say, in springtime when I get ready to go to Buffalo. For the summer, I can't work, but I can draw. And then there's been more of an interest in exhibitions and shows. You look at Alcarlos and drawings, which I kind of did again. And I don't know if that's where Paul saw those and decided that we should put them here. And these I did during the summer. But both of us keep, Jeff better, has more extensive sketchbook than I do right now. Skills pots in there. Mine is filled with sort of a hodgepodge of forms we're going to make and all the different kinds of things. You know, I looked through the newspaper, saw this hat, as an example. The gloss cap, or you adopt this cap, and you know, here was this cat, it is this white cat. People look at the eye. Keep an ongoing little thing, or something shows up in a newspaper, an idea, things like that. So I do keep sketchbooks more constant than those I've done periodically, not every day. But I just did this workshop in Nebraska, and I made one of these stretched platters. I mean, I stretched this thing out there for the oval. So I make this long platter, like with fish and pork. Pork and stuff on them, you know? And it's kind of a nice little form. Anyways, I was drawing this fish and we got in touch with everything. And he said, have you ever made a print from that? So we got some paper and we rolled ink on it and made a print stuff. So just sort of add this the whole thing. And it turned out pretty good. And probably 20 years ago, I got invited to go and make some prints.
And when they send them all back to me,
was really great because I think I just make the pot and leave it. And the whole process of firing it up. And I thought, what a great thing. So Chuck builds a wood kiln for me, and he designs it. He comes down and helps me build it. And I manage the fire. It isn't quite the same if you do all that work yourself.
What, so when you come to the point where you're unloading the kiln, what's your success rate like?
For wood?
That or in general?
Somebody asked this last night. For me, wood probably 20%. I mean, there are other people that put stuff in my kiln. That turns out better than mine. But it's just that for me, 7, 8, 9. And unfortunately, they're all little T-bolts.
The 20% that's good is T-bolts.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah. But there's one or two big ones over the years. So, but it's probably 20%. But you get to re-fire those again. So, and then the low-fire salt generally is maybe 60 to 70%. But the painted stuff, it's all done prior to the firing. There are no surprises. I mean, I do see them in different lights when they come out. But it's 95. It's a 98%.
Do you find that that affects the amount of juice you get from the experience?
No, I'd rather make the wood fire pot.
So maybe that chance, there's a higher chance of failure makes it more...
Well, I love the process of that. The activity and all that, and the involvement.
You're totally different than
just something to cut and dry truck, the painted stuff. But, you know, that's where. The challenge there over the years is not only to change the forms, but also making the paint better, more vital than it was at the very beginning. And if you see a pot of iron from the 1980s, it's different than what it is now. Not necessarily better, I don't think, but it's different, certainly. A little bit more naive. I think these are, I've gotten better with the brushwork and the layout. I get the involvement with it, so there's been some evolution in it. I'm not unhappy with it, but it's a different challenge. So I'd like to change. I couldn't do that painted stuff every day. So I'd like to have immediacy about the wood, but I don't have to do anything. Just make the form. You don't have to bisque it. Put the glaze in it. You don't have to. And I just stick it in the kiln. So it's almost immediately so real into the fire. Not quite like that. There's that. And then there's the whole process of firing. When you have to get a team up in artists and get it. Former students, Chuck's come down and help me fire. I'm always looking for somebody who knows something. I don't know anything about it. I'm trying to learn. And the learning curve is very difficult. But the temptation. So he stopped by to help finish firing the kiln. And when no one's looking and we're down there firing, he says, "How are you doing? Are you having a party or are you firing a kiln?" So that makes sense. So I needed him to tell those people to leave. I couldn't do it. But they didn't. Anyway, that's just a temptation. But we need to be there.
It's not a mindless act, you know, like where you open the door and you toss a couple sticks in.
and then you close it and you shoot the breeze for a while. Then you go back, at least for me it's not. It's a thing that's all consuming. I have to really pay attention, watch the kill and see what's going on, and I don't like a lot of people around, especially chit-chat and asking questions, because it interferes with what I'm doing. Again, it's not a mindless situation. It's sort of like a old-time potter, Ken Thunderson, was at the grave. Sunday morning after church, this lawyer shows up while Ken's making pot. And he sits around for 2 hours with his kids running around the studio and talking to him. And finally, he gets ready to leave. And he said, Ken, he said, thanks for letting us hang around for, so on. Ken says, I said, I'm coming down to your law office tomorrow morning with my kids and my wife. I'm going to shoot the shit with you for 2 hours. And it's, I think sometimes people don't understand that when you're working, especially for me, I can't concentrate on what I'm doing if I'm talking to somebody or answering questions. I remember one guy showed up one time and was really interested in the tea ceremony. He had a tea house and everything. He stood there and talked for about 45 minutes. It took me 2 hours to get the kill back to where it was when he walked up and started talking. I mean, I lost temperature. There's a rhythm you get into. For me, anyway, I have to maintain that. It's really quite involved. It's not just tossing a piece of wood and kill. Maybe some people can do that, right? Process that I pay attention to all the time.
So the smartest thing for me would have been to just hook up with these guys and just ship my pots to them. And not have to go. But then you don't have control over it or not.
If I want right away, I'll put it back in the kill again. It's like a painter laying down grounds of color, maybe scraping some off, going back, laying over the top of that. Printmaker takes a plate, pulls proof, not satisfied with what's there, can go back, lay down another ground image, whatever, rebite the plate, ink it, pull it, and just keep working until you get what you want. And as far as I'm concerned, that's what it's about with the pot. So I have a student that mentioned that to one time, and he said, well, you can't get it right the first time or something. Well, that's not necessarily true, I don't think, because there are layers on the pots that you would never get through one fire, that build up. And some of it burns off and is obliterated, but there are things added to it that weren't there before that you wouldn't have taken up on. So I don't think ever got 50% wood firing or second firing. It's always looking at them, but part of it might be looking and making judgments too quickly. Mm-hmm. We were talking about this the other night, the expectations you have when you remove the pots from the kiln. If they're not met immediately, you know, you have this idea of what you want it to look like. And if it doesn't look like that, you're disappointed and you don't look at it enough to see what's there that might not have been originally. So I try to keep the pieces around a little bit more and look at them and then make up my mind whether or not. I'm going to make some bowls. You used to throw these. Again, they got to the point where they were really overworked and contrived. So I started hand building them, and I use this process.
Hey,
let's go out and take that near bear right outside.
when you unload the kill, the autonomous kill, I have a friend who can tell you that I've fired or killed a fire. I didn't party, I hope you're fine. But when she unloads it, she always, it's very methodical and puts it in order of where everything was in the kill and then photographs and records where things were. Do you go to that extreme?
Sometimes.
Does it help?
That's like making your kids when you're Christmas time, opening their presents, putting them down, okay, this one came from Aunt Mary, this one came from whatever before they get, you know. I didn't do that. Unload them all. Put them over there. We'll sort them out later.
Part of it, you know, it's not my kill anyway, was never stacked the same any two times. I know some people have eaten shelves in the same spot and then just slide the pots in. I take the whole thing down and when I load the next time, it's a completely different pot. Shelves are never in the same place, they're not the same height, so on and so forth.
You fire with cones or pyrometer?
Cones, and if I'm firing with students, and even now, I'll use a pyrometer in the beginning to give me an idea. Like Ron said, I don't bisque where you fire green. I just go real slow in the beginning, partly to even the temperature up in the kiln, but also to go slow enough that you don't damage any of the pots or the sudden surge of heat. But I'll use cones.
When you refire your pots, do you find that you have cracking that happens because they're being refired?
Very occasionally.
But not
very seldom.
Do you think that's because you fire slowly because you don't want to fire?
I think if you know that the body's tight and so on, if you go through 14 versions too quickly, it expands. And I've heard a couple of them go off like a rocket, but very seldom. But I go real slow too. I don't try to go quickly.
It helps that you fire with greenware in there.
Part of it, yeah. But even if I was going to fire a whole kill load of refire, I'd go slower. Just so that there wasn't a problem.
So with the cones, back to the cones, just one more question about them. Do you use them as a way to gauge a top end, like a limit, or do you use them as like a stopping point?
A little of each. Mainly, in most cases, it was a top end to stop. Also, there's a guard cone there not to go to that one, the last one. It's kind of a safety device, but the best of intentions of men in high school.
Sure, yeah. Definitely.
One morning I just left the shop. I was on till 9 o'clock and I went home, went to bed, and was going to go back at 6. About 4:30 the phone rings and one of the graduates said that Ben thinks the first tier of shelves has fallen into the firebox. Should we stop stoking? And I said, well, yeah, that sounds like out there. And come to find out, one of the bricks had gone terminal on us and started to melt. Luckily, it caught on the rim of a friend's teapot and kept it from going in. And when I got there, it was white hot. I mean, it took me a while to get my eyes accustomed to seeing the pots, and there weren't any cones. I mean, and so, anyway, we shut it down. And then later on, we did what called reduction cooling. Okay. But anyway, the student that was on that night when I left, he came in the next day and I said, Dan, I said, and I told him, I said, don't drop 10 tonight. When I come back in the morning, we'll get it where we want, but don't drop 10. And so he shows up and I said, Dan, I said, how hot was the kill last night? And he said, I don't know. I said, what do you mean? That I couldn't see him. He just kept stoking until he dropped everything and then just kept going. And so the whole idea of the cones didn't work out too well. And
type of ship.
Take your coil of clay and then bend it around.
We did a little break.
Yeah. Flatten it out and then set that on the shelf inside the spy hole. And then when you get up to a given temperature, we take a break.
We're taking a break.
Then you just run steel rod through that, lift it up and take it out, and quench it in water. And that'll give you a good idea of the ashes. Won't give you an idea of the atmosphere in the kiln because it'll oxidize since it hits the water as cool. So you can't tell what construction is like, which I get to serve the idea. Also, one thing you could do during the fire is take a metal rod, stick it in the spy hole or stoke hole, and then hold it up against the pot. If you see that reflection against the pot, you know you've got ash built up and there's glaze on it. If it's real dry, you can't see anything. If you're after that effect, then you want to keep going.
The reason I ask is because, especially with someone like where you deal with very little glaze, cones don't really mean much to the surfaces that you're not melting a glaze. Per se, so you know, cone 10 versus cone 9 versus cone 8. That's
just an idea, and like I was talking about yesterday, and I'll use some of your clay here in a minute. But I would put the high iron bodies in the back, and I would try not to go above cone 7.
Mm-hmm.
Pardon me, because I felt that burned the colors out.
I agree.
So I definitely didn't want to go any higher than that. But then I'd keep checking also that rod to see what the surface was doing, if there was. If it's a little buildup or not, it depends. And again, those surfaces at cone 6 are a little drier and not as watery as the up front, where I would use lighter bodies that have more kale in it. And that's not good.
Really?
Yeah, that's how I enjoy it.